In this video lecture, we want to take a little closer look at program output capabilities using the standard print commands related to Java's System class. Okay, let's get started. There are two key Java System constants that we've already seen, System.in and System.out, but we should have a little better understanding of these. First of all, System is one of Java's core classes, and it's part of the java.lang package, so we always get to use it without needing to import it. It contains some useful methods and two static constants that are of particular interest to us. The first such static constant is System.in, which represents Java's standard input, which by default is the keyboard. In reality, in is a static instance variable of the System class, and it by itself is of type InputStream, which is yet another Java class. But for practical purposes, we refer to it as System.in, and we've recently seen that it is used to instantiate any new scanner object to receive input from the keyboard. The other such static constant is System.out, and this represents Java's standard output device, which by default is the Java console or command line. Similarly, out is a static instance variable of the System class, and by itself is of type PrintStream, which is still another Java class. Similarly, for practical purposes, we refer to it as System.out, and no doubt we recognize that this is the beginnings of Java's standard print methods. If all of the preceding was a little unclear, don't worry, that's perfectly understandable. I had the same reaction when I first encountered all this, until I finally took a look at the System class API. I encourage you to pause for a moment and do that for yourself. Here's an excerpt from the System API. This is the first part showing its instance variables. We see that both in and out are static instance variables, which explains why they are usually preceded by System dot, the name of their class. Then we note that each one is itself of some other class data type. And if we were to click on this hyperlink for PrintStream and drill down into the next level details, we'd see the familiar println and print methods, as we'll see next. So next, here are the APIs for the two primary Java print methods, which as we just saw are actually part of the PrintStream class, although we generally always use them prefaced by the familiar System.out. Each of these methods simply prints whatever data it is given out to the standard output, which of course is the command line or screen. If you were to look at these methods closely in the PrintStream API, you'd see that they each have many overloaded forms, which simply means that they can print out data of any data type, be it a string, some core numerical type, or even any Java object, as we'll see next. You give these methods anything, and they will display it to the screen. The only difference between these two methods is that println displays the data followed by a newline character, whereas print does not add this newline character, which is why we often prefer it to display input prompts when using scanner. Here's an example of the difference. This first print statement displays the text, "The answer is," but leaves the output cursor placed at the end of that text, as shown here in red. The second print statement then prints the text equivalent of this numeric 42, but then kicks the output cursor down to the next line. At this point, I suggest that you pause this video and view the short code walkthrough video for printexamples.java, which contains a number of related print examples, more than we can reasonably cover here. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find this example in the usual place. Come back to this video when you are finished. It turns out that every class in Java has some toString method, whose purpose is to convert its object's data into some equivalent string representation. This is the generic API that holds for any class. It takes no input arguments and returns a string version of the object's data. For example, we saw this when we examined the CS12Date class. Its toString method returns the month, day, and year instance variables in the typical date format, as we see here at the bottom. All classes have such a method, and it's generally considered good practice to explicitly provide one. Even when that's not the case, then some parent class or some ultimate ancestor object class will provide one by default, free of charge. Whenever we try to print any object using the system.out.print or println methods, Java will automatically or implicitly call that object's toString method. So in this example at the bottom, The following print outputs are identical. If we instantiate a new CS12 date object today as shown, either of these print statements will give the same result, using object.toString explicitly, or just the name of the object implicitly. So in most cases, it's just simplest to print out an object using its name only, and this is why it works. Now remember that for lengthy strings, Java allows both the source code statements and any resulting outputs to span multiple lines. On the source code side, we can break up long print statements over multiple lines using string concatenation, and on the output display side, we can make our output text more readable by embedding within it such characters as a backslash n new line or a backslash t tab. Use these types of things in your code for improved code clarity and readability. As I often like to say, let your code breathe, both on the page and in the output that it displays. Here are a couple code examples of things you can do in this regard. On the left side, we're setting up a scanner object, shown here in red, to read in a char user option. Maybe we have a lengthy text prompt that we're going to be using over and over again, and we want to span multiple lines for readability. One thing we can do in our code is to break up that string over multiple lines using string concatenation, as we see here. Then, to ensure that each user option is displayed on a separate line, we might choose to embed these new line characters in the midst of our string. Also, notice that we've elected to set this up as a string constant using the final keyword and all caps and underscores. Then whenever we want to reissue this user prompt, we simply provide the name of this string constant before trying to read in a single char using our scanner object. This next line might look kind of strange because of the multiple dot notation involved, but what we're trying to do here is make sure that we are returning a capital letter for the user input. So if we break this down left to right, we're first reading in an entire line as a string, then applying the toUpperCase method to that string, which results in yet another string, and finally peeling off the first character using char at zero. So when all is said and done, this entire right-hand expression evaluates to one single uppercase letter, which is what we want read into the user option char variable. On the right side, here's an example of how we might structure a print statement that involves a lengthy string concatenation. More generally, we could also apply this to any lengthy method call to make it more readable in our code. Here, we are initializing some fictitious person object. Then we want to print out the labeled values for its instance variables. Since Java allows statements to span multiple lines, we are breaking up the string concatenation over three lines, such that each line contains the output label together with its value as object.accessor method. Since we have a terminating parenthesis and semicolon, this is a perfectly valid statement. It's much more readable this way, and it doesn't spill off the right-hand margin of our display. At this point, I'll again suggest that you end this video and view the short code walkthrough video for printExamples.java, which gives more examples of what we've just discussed for printing objects and making output text more readable, both in code and as output. Okay, that does it for this subject, and I hope you have a clearer idea of performing command line output in your programs.